Well, hey, how are you this fine day? Well, things are looking beautiful here in Florida. It is the 1st of January, and I hope you had a wonderful 2022. Here we are in 2023, and it's looking good so far. What's going to happen over the next 6 weeks is that we put together the top programs that you, the viewer, have chosen as being the top programs of the Chapel Hour. And let me tell you, it's going to be great. These were some fantastic programs, and everybody loved them, and they got a lot of activity, and we just believe that they're worthy of seeing a second time. So these are previously recorded programs that you're about to see for the next 6 weeks, but they're not just any previously recorded programs. They're the best of 2022 of the Chapel Hour. Right after these six, I want to just give you a little bit of a teaser, because right after this, we're going to see an update from Jim and Becky Leach from Romania. That's fantastic. You will not want to miss that. Then right after that, we've got a two-hour program where Ruth, Rebecca, Rachel, and I stood around the piano and just sang every song that we knew and all the memories that we had. And a lot of you are part of that program because we talked about you. Ooh, yep, you're gonna wanna not miss that program. And then at the very end, right before we start up with the Wisehart Family Singers and the Chapel Hour again for 2023, we're gonna show the bloopers of the Wisehart Family Singers and the Chapel Hour. Won't wanna miss that either. You're gonna get a good laugh out of that, I promise. But for now, just sit back and enjoy for the next 6 weeks the best of the best, the cream of the crop of the Chapel Hour and the Wisehart Family Singers. I think you're going to enjoy this.
Oh. Hey, Daddy. Congratulations on your 100th episode of the Chapel Hour. Mwah.
Daddy, I know when you and Mother moved to Florida, you thought your life was over and you were going to just retire and do nothing. But God opened up an opportunity for you to do even more than what you were doing before, reaching even more people than you ever dreamed of. And I just want to congratulate you on 100 programs that you've already got under your belt. And I hope you have many more. God bless you. And you know how much we love you.
Well, it looks like congratulations are in order to the Wisehart family singers and Reverend Russell Wisehart for putting together 2 solid years of programming. This has been something that's required a lot of hard work and a lot of behind the scenes action on everybody. And I'm so proud of my family. I'm so proud of you, Dad, for doing such an amazing job these last couple of years. The best thing that I can take away from all of this is that this has not just been just for this time frame, the last 2 years, but because of the internet, because of YouTube, because of Facebook, guess what? It's gonna be around for a long, long time.
We are so excited that we are celebrating our 100th episode this year. We started when COVID started to where we were having church in our house, and Daddy and Mama moved down here to just go on a vacation for their anniversary, but they ended up staying here. And we found an outlet for Daddy to use his talents, and he has just flourished in this, and we're so excited that it's still going on. And we're so happy and so thankful for all of you that have been watching through, I get a little choked up, but thank you for watching us and for praying for us, and as we've been praying for you too through the years. And we just are so happy, and we thank you for being with us, and happy 100th, Daddy.
The 6th word on the cross, as John reports it, is the Greek word tetelestai. It is finished. In the Greek language, that's only one word. In our language, it is 3 words. But as Jesus is hanging on the cross, he cries out in a loud voice twice. In the 4th word, Jesus' cry is called a cry of dereliction, or a cry of someone who feels abandoned or left alone. The 6th word is called a cry of triumph. The hours of suffering were almost over, and Jesus is just about ready to die. He has prayed for his enemies. He has answered the prayer of a dying thief. He has made provision for his mother. He has provided an opportunity for John to take his mother in and care for her for the rest of her days. He has felt forsaken and alone. He has felt an agonizing thirst. And now we hear him cry out once again with a loud voice. Matthew, Mark, and Luke say only that Jesus cried out with a loud voice. Matthew 27:50, Mark 15:37, and Luke 23:46. Only John tells us what Jesus said in that loud voice. It is finished. This saying of Jesus, as I mentioned, is 3 words in our English language, but it is only 1 word in the Greek language, tetelestai. This word is translated, it stands completed. When Jesus was teaching, he often talked about counting the cost and completing or finishing the task. In Luke chapter 9, verse 62, Jesus said, "No man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." Luke 14, verses 28 to 31, we read, "For which of you intending to build a tower sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest haply after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it will begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to war against another king sitteth not down first and consults whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that comes against him with 20,000. Jesus did not leave his task unfinished. Just a few hours before the crucifixion in the Garden of Gethsemane, we hear Jesus saying, "Father, I have finished the work which you gave me to do." John 4:34, he says, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work." So what is it that Jesus has finished? Someone, I could not find the source, wrote the following. "Finished. This word spoken by our Lord as he hung on the nails might have been the saddest that ever fell from human lips. He might thus have been putting a bloody period to a life whose dearest dreams and holiest hopes had been in utter failure. In the far north, at the foot of Mount McKinley, a skeleton was found seated on the root of a tree. Just above was a finger carved in the bark, pointing down to the skeleton. Beside the finger were these words, 'The end of the trail.' They told the tragic story of one who had set out to climb the lofty mountain, but his strength had failed him. He had died with his purpose unrealized. But is this all these words mean? Even so, by this word 'finished,' Jesus might have meant simply that he himself had reached the end of his trail. He might have thus been saying, 'I'm through. I've gone my limit, having won nothing but shame, defeat, and death.' But this word is not in reality a wail of despair. On the contrary, it is a shout of triumph. It was uttered in the thrill of an irrepressible joy." So this cry of Jesus is not like the cry of dereliction when Jesus felt like God had abandoned him. This is not a cry of distress or pain. This is not a cry of resignation or defeat. Jesus was not crying out in self-pity or futility. Jesus did not die with his purpose, or should I say God's purpose, unrealized. This loud cry was a shout of triumph. It is finished. It stands completed. Now, scholars, or at least some scholars, have made much of the perfect passive tense in which this one Greek word is written. In the Greek language, it describes an action that's in progress, that has come to a point of completion, and it exists as a completed result, and the effects of this result continue to the present time. Well, what does this mean as far as we're concerned in this situation? It means from the very beginning of the Bible, Genesis 3:15, perhaps even further back from that, because the Bible says Jesus was crucified from the beginning of the world. But from the beginning of the Bible, Genesis 3:15, God's plan of redemption had been in progress. In the fullness of time, Galatians says, chapter 4, verse 4, in the fullness of time, God sent his Son into this old sinful world to seek and to save that which was lost. And when Jesus cried on the cross, the plan of God for salvation was completed. It had been in progress. It was completed with Jesus' death and resurrection. And the results or effects of what Jesus did continue to this very day, and they will until Jesus comes again. Hallelujah. So what happened on the cross means that God has done everything that he could do and everything that man could not do. The suffering and death of Jesus are prophesied beautifully in Isaiah chapter 53, verses 5 and 6. "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. It is hard for us to understand all that took place on that little hill just outside Jerusalem. In Romans chapter 11, Paul writes about the restoration of Israel and the salvation of the Gentiles, and it was hard for him to understand all that God was doing in a way, but towards the end of the chapter, it seems that he just gets carried away, and all at once he cries out, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out." We don't need to pray, "God, do something." He has done it. In the cross and resurrection, the work has been completed. Everything that divine love could do to help us become children of God has been done by God through Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19 says, "God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, and then he has committed to us the ministry of reconciliation." It is finished. Well, what was the work that Jesus finished? The work which he said the Father sent him to do. He came to seek and to save the lost, Luke 19:10. He came that men might have life and have it more abundantly, John chapter 10, verse 10. He came to build a kingdom that is not of this world. He came to reveal the Father. You remember when Philip came and said, "Lord, show us the Father." And Jesus said, "Philip, have I been so long with you, and have you not known that he that's seen me has seen the Father?" He came to show us the Father. He came to give us the supreme example of divine love at Calvary. And it's this love that has inspired men and women to live and die for Jesus down through the years. It has destroyed the powers of evil and darkness. It has radiated throughout the world, and it will finally triumph in the end. From the cross came that cry, "It is finished." Finished. His persecutors had done their worst. He's now going out of their reach. Finished. His Father's will has now been done. Finished. All the types and prophecies from Genesis 3:15 to this moment on the cross have now been fulfilled. Finished. The Old Testament ceremonial law has now been abolished, and the new, better way Jeremiah wrote about has begun. But this shall be my covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Finished. Jesus, the one who made the one sacrifice for sin forever, has been obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Finished. His sufferings are now over. The storm is past. His pain and agony are at an end. Finished. Jesus' mortal life is now coming to an end. He has finished his course. The world's redemption is now completed. Finished. Jesus is now preparing to leave this world and take up his new position as our intercessor at the right hand of the Father. Finished. But is it really? True, Christ's earthly work is finished, and he has begun his heavenly ministry as our intercessor. But our work is not finished. Go back to 2 Corinthians 5:19. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. Then he's given to us the ministry of reconciliation. An old hymn of the church says, "Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all." Jesus loved to the end. And now he asks that we love even as he loved. You read from Jesus' words and then all through the epistles, those words again and again. Love one another. Love one another. Love one another as I have loved you. We do not do this by loving the church. The ordinances or the services, as important as they are and as necessary as they are, but we do this by loving people, unlovable people, impatient people, difficult people, impossible people, all kinds of people. It's been said that one of our greatest weaknesses is a lack of love one for another. Communities, churches, denominations, individuals. What we sometimes see a semblance of love during times of crisis, when there are earthquakes or floods or storms or disasters of this type. But this kind of love often fluctuates and is temporary. Jesus taught that we are to love one another consistently, day after day, month after month, hour after hour, year after year. John 13, verses 34 and 35, Jesus said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." If we desire more love, we must practice more love. God desires His will be done here on earth. He desires a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. He desires a Christ-like people. This happens as we believe and receive and obey and follow and serve the Lord. It is finished, Jesus cried there. He paid it all. Nothing good that we can do can help us out. Jesus did it all. He did everything divine love could do to redeem the world. He left us the task of reflecting that love to the world. It is finished. And because of the finished work of Christ, we can now come boldly to the throne of grace that we might find mercy and find grace to help us carry out the Great Commission and reflect His love in all we do and everywhere we go. I want to finish with a little poem I wrote over 60 years ago when I was thinking of this word, "It is finished." And this is what I wrote. "It is finished," Jesus cried, as upon the tree He died, shed His blood, my sins to hide. Finished on the cross. Naught could cover up my vice, but by His free sacrifice, willingly He paid the price, cleansed away my dross. "What is finished?" I had said, as I gazed upon Him dead, grave clothes wrapped around His head, laid within the tomb. "Hope is gone. My Lord is dead." Then in fear I turned and fled, locked myself in fear and dread, trembling in my room. There I felt an unseen hand, heard a gentle reprimand. "Dost thou still not understand His great love for thee? 'Twas for you the Savior came, bore your guilt, your sin, your shame. Willingly He took the blame on that cruel tree." Broken then, I bowed my head. "Precious Lord, forgive," I said. "Can my spirit still be led from this frightful gloom? Can there still be hope for me? Can these blinded eyes yet see at yon fountain? Can there be that for me there's room?" As I did His name extol, sweet assurance filled my soul. Joy that I could not control shook my trembling pain. "It is finished," said my Lord. "It is finished," precious word. "It is finished, grace outpoured. Praise His precious name. It is finished. It stands completed. Your sins have been paid for. All you have to do is put your faith in Him." Shall we pray? Father, there are only three words in our English language. Oh, but what import they make spiritually to us. It's not just some little thing that was finished, some little recipe or some little job or something like that. It's the plan of salvation. It was what the whole Old Testament looks forward to. The prophets look forward to that time. And Lord, even Jesus, as He walked this earth, several times He told His disciples, "It's going to be necessary for me to go to Jerusalem to be mistreated and to be crucified. It's going to be necessary so that the sins of the world can be redeemed." And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for those three words. It is finished. It stands completed. Hallelujah. We thank you. I pray right now, if there's anyone that's unsaved, that somehow this will make an impression on them, that their sins have been blotted out. Their sins have been blotted out. Jesus has taken care of that. Now all they have to do is turn to him, believe on him, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. They told the jailer, and you will be saved. And that's all you have to do. Believe on Jesus and begin to follow him. And Christian friend, if you're there, I trust that these three words will make an impact upon your heart anew and afresh during this Easter season. It is finished. Jesus paid the price. All to him we owe now. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, and now he has given unto you and to me and to all believers everywhere the ministry of reconciliation. Let's go out beginning today and love others as he loved us and do what we can to fulfill that word of scripture that says that God left to us the ministry of reconciliation. Let's go out and see what we can do to help men and women be reconciled to you, to the Lord. We pray all this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today for The Chapel Hour with Reverend Russell Wisehart and the Wisehart Family Singers. For previous programs, please go to YouTube and search for the Wisehart Family Singers channel. If you're a minister, teacher, or student of the Bible and would like to access Reverend Wisehart's messages, outlines, and sermon notes, please go to thechapelhour.blogspot.com. And of course, one of the best ways to stay in touch with us is on the Wisehart Family Singers Facebook page. We want to thank everyone for finding us, for your encouragement, for subscribing to our channel, and for hitting that little like button. We look forward to seeing you next week on The Chapel Hour.